So welcome all of you to the 27th live webinar on orthopedic principles. Our guest speaker now is Dr. Sandeep Patel. Dr. Patel completed his post-graduation from Postgraduate Institute and Medical Research, Chandigarh, India. And now he works as assistant professor in the same institute. His research interests are orthobiologics, PRP, scaffolds, and his clinical interests are in arthroplasty and pelvioacetabular surgery. He has several publications to his credit. Many of them are in high impact journals, including the American Journal of Sports Medicine. Today, he's going to enlighten us on orthobiologics and PRP. Over to you, Dr. Patel. You can share your screen.
Thank you so much. It's a pleasure to be here in a great teaching. It's a good initiative from you. So it's my pleasure to take part in the Orthopedic Principles teaching session. Greetings from Chandigarh. Hope everyone is doing good and staying safe. So my topic for the day is PRP injection for knee osteoarthritis and then other musculoskeletal problems. We have a lot of many orthopedic problems. We are all trying solutions for them, but some seems to be tough and unresolved issues with some healing troubles. The two major issues in orthopedics, one is tissue stabilization and the other is tissue healing. This seems to be well taken care of, good advancements, and this we have been doing for the last 70 years. However, tissue healing is still a problem. Even today, some healing issues remain unresolved. So lateral thinking for these problems has evolved. So new ideas have taken birth. We are now in search for the holy grail in orthopedics. We want that cup desperately so that we can have quick healing, faster recovery, and at the same time, safety. But where do we search for the answer? So we need to have a changing thought process. As I said, the lateral thinking. What exactly is our lateral thinking? Yes, look inside the body for solutions. Have you ever wondered how the wounds heal, the scars fade, the bones unite? The power of healing is inherent within us. It is just that this healing needs the correct signals. We just need to jumpstart the healing of the tissues using body's own available products. So, welcome to orthobiologics. So what is orthobiologics? It refers to a substance that orthopedic surgeons use to help injuries heal more quickly, that are usually made from substance naturally found in their own body and can be used for the healing of fractured bones, injured muscles, tendons, and ligaments. The orthobiologics broadly has got three categories, and this is the heart of it. For adequate healing, we need to look at these three components. One is the matrix, wherein we have the bone graft, which has been the oldest form of orthobiologic substance we have been using. It could be the autograft or the allograft, which has got all the properties of osteoinduction, conduction, and osteogenesis. And nowadays, the artificial matrix of most important is the scaffolds. The second is the stem cells, where we talk about the bone marrow spirit concentrate or the adipose-derived stem cells. And much advanced, it's the cultured stem cells wherein we get 100% concentrated stem cells. Third and the most important is the growth factors, wherein the leader is the platelet-rich plasma, the autologous conditioned serum, and a lot of segregated, isolated synthetic peptides. The topic for today would be platelet-rich plasma. I would present it in two halves. First, I will deal with the knee per se, and then I would go on to the musculoskeletal indications. So what is PRP? It is the plasma fraction of autologous blood with the platelet concentration above baseline. At least 4 to 5 times concentration is required if we need to label the product as PRP. There are a lot of synonyms: platelet-enriched plasma, platelet-rich concentrate, platelet-rich fibrin. All these are some variants of PRP. The use of PRP, the idea took hold in the early 21st century, a lot of hope, but with limited evidence. There were a lot of communications, review articles. 2010, it was much about discussion. However, evidence has accumulated over the last 10 years. So we have to believe in evidence-based medicine. Today, if there's no evidence-based medicine, nobody literally hears to us. So let's see what the evidence says. So what is the rationale for use of PRP? The rationale is that PRP is a complex mixture of bioactive proteins which is required for repair. The alpha granules within the PRP has got all of these growth factors like a PDGF, vascular endothelial growth factors, transforming growth factors, beta. These alpha granules are rich source, and when they degranulate, they give in this cocktail mixture, and this cocktail mixture is what is most important. So let's see what PRP does for osteoarthritis. And the learning objectives for this would be, how does PRP work in osteoarthritis knee? Why PRP and how does it help? Which PRP to choose? How many PRP injections are required? And which are the ideal patients? So first question is, how PRP works for knee osteoarthritis? It seems to act at the cartilage, the synoviocytes, the anti-inflammatory pathways and the apoptosis. There are a lot of preclinical studies, both in vivo and in vitro, which say the same. We at PGI have developed an animal model, guinea pig animal model of osteoarthritis, where we have been doing a lot of experimental work. And these are some of the experimental work we have done. So this is the pictures of the guinea pigs, where they're kept, how we inject the PRP and stuff. So this was one of a study, initial in vivo study in guinea pigs, where in the left we have the platelet-rich plasma and on the right we have the control. So we can see the multiple fissures in the control, which is a normal saline extending, and also a diffuse loss of the extracellular matrix as the proteoglycans. But there's a good normal cellularity in the PRP and the empty lacuna in that. That's how PRP works. And when we look at the synovium, we see a lot of difference. Again, left and right, if you can see, there is minimal hyperplasia and inflammation in the PRP, but a lot of hyperplasia and inflammation, which signifies the anti-inflammatory effect of the PRP. So this was published in the MLTJ journal. Again, how exactly does PRP affect the chondrocytes? There is a belief that the chondrocytes are also preserved, the conditions of chondrocytes are preserved. So these are in vitro good studies which says the apoptotic pathways are affected. These are in vitro. In vitro meaning they take some chondrocytes culture in the cell in a petri dish, and then they start analyzing the properties of chondrocytes. We, however, did a first in vivo study in an animal model wherein we used the immunohistochemistry and caspase-3. Caspase-3 is basically synonymous with apoptosis. So if the caspase-3 is expressed, that means cell death takes place. So in our study, we can see that in the left, there is a lot of staining, and that lot of staining of the brown color is actually the normal saline group, and the right is the PRP where there is no caspase expression. That means multiple doses of PRP has an anti-apoptotic effect at 3 months, which also persisted till 6 months. We also looked using immunohistochemistry, the aggregant, that is the extracellular matrix, which is good in PRP group. That is, the PRP has got effect on the cellular component, which is the chondrocytes, and then the extracellular matrix, that is the aggregant. So PRP seems to work in all these structures to give in the effect. So well, let's see. Let's go to the clinical studies. Why PRP in ONE, and should we actually start using in a clinical practice? What is the evidence? So our first PRP study, which in fact was the first randomized controlled trial for a PRP in osteoarthritis knee study, it was published in the American Journal of Sports Medicine with 550 plus citations so far. The evidence of the study, if we see the parameters of a study, almost all the parameters are good. There is no selection bias. There is no performance bias. There is no blinding bias. There is no attrition bias. It's one of the well-conducted study which has been graded. This grades the quality of study. This I have taken from a good meta-analysis which have graded our study. So let me share our study. This was well back in 2010 when we carried out the study. So we had three groups. One group, that is group A, received a single injection of PRP. Other group B received two injections of PRP at 3 week interval, and a group C which received normal saline. During that time, our PRP preparation, we used to take 100 ml of whole blood. This was done in the transfusion medicine department. Then it used to undergo a soft spin, that is the first spin of 1500 RPM. Then we used a leukocyte filter because we had concerns regarding the presence of leukocytes, which can be deleterious. And then we got the final product, which was leukocyte PRP, leukocyte free PRP. It was a Mishra type 4B classification. And we injected through the superolateral pole of Patella and used calcium chloride as an activator. We did the follow-up evaluation at 6 weeks, 3 months, and 6 months with the WOMAC score and VAS scores. And let's see what the scoring says. If you have a look at here, the yellow is the control group, and the green and the purple ones are the group A and B, that is single and two injections respectively. We can see how good the scores are there in the PRP arm with respect to the pain, and same the stiffness, and the same with the physical function score and the total WOMAC score. So let's move on. If we want to establish that PRP has a role in osteoarthritis knee, we need to answer at three questions. The first question is safety of PRP use. Second is, how does PRP do when we compare with normal saline, that is a placebo? Third is with visco supplement, which is the established mode right now. So what does the evidence say? It is completely safe, the first part of the question. It is backed by a huge amount of scientific data, at least 17 randomized controlled trial, 7 plus meta-analysis, and 25 plus clinical studies. In a recent meta-analysis, the pooled relative risk for adverse reactions of PRP is similar to that of hyaluronic acid administration. There is no significant difference. That is, PRP's adverse effect is equivalent to HA. That is, it is completely safe. So the next part of the question, how does it do versus placebo? As we presented our study, we were the first to establish PRP superiority over placebo. That was the first trial. In 2016, we had a US FDA approved trial of a leukocyte poor PRP versus normal saline, which again said that PRP works and it is completely safe. Apart from this, there are at least 3-4 other level 2, level 3 study which supports the same. Next, let's move to Hyaluron. There are a lot of studies, randomized controlled trial, prospective cohort studies. Every study usually compare with the Hyaluron, and all comparative studies are in favor of PRP. However, there are 2 to 3 studies which says PRP is similar to Hyaluron. This is a trial from Elisabetta Kahn and the team from Italy. If you look at the title, it's so misleading, they say, shows no superiority versus visco supplementation. But then if you have a clear look at the paper, the KSS scores were better than visco supplements, but they could not attain statistical significance. Another paper from the Dimas and team from the Turkey, the KSSTA, they said PRP is similar to Hyaluron at 3 and 6 months, but at 12 months, PRP was better than Hyaluron. Now, let's see, because as of today, we at least have 17 to 18 randomized controlled trials, so we can rely on the meta-analysis. We had these two meta-analyses from the 2015, and then these two meta-analyses from the 2017, and all these meta-analysis results said that PRP led to improvement in pain scores at 3, 6, and 12 months, and that it's better than visco supplements. Well, I have recently added these two meta-analyses, which I picked from 2020. It included a 14-hour series of 1,350 patients. And compared to Hyaluron, PRP offered advantages for knee osteoarthritis to reduce long-term pain and improve function. This and other meta-analysis, 10 RCTs, 1,096 patients. First 2 months, PRP was similar to Hyaluron, but at the 3rd, 6th, and 12th month of follow-up, the pooled analysis showed that PRP was much better. And this meta-analysis looked at those cohorts who were overweight and obese, and even in them, it seems to have an action. Now, does PRP a role, and should we start using our clinical practice? Let's see what Timothy J. Hunt, the associated editor of the Arthroscopic Association of North America, has to say. He said in 2016 that the time has come for those who are not started to actually start using PRP in the clinical practice. Now that we know PRP does something, it is giving a symptomatic relief. which PRP should we use? Are all PRP the same? We got buffy coat versus plasma based. We got single spin versus double spin. We got leukocyte rich versus leukocyte poor. My dear friends, all PRP products are not the same. They can vary in accordance with the volume of the blood extracted, the inclusion or exclusion of WBCs, whether the platelets are activated, and whether there's formation of a fibrin matrix or so. We have the Mishra classification, which exactly takes into account whether there's leukocytes there, whether it is activated, and the concentration. And a much elaborate classification is the POR classification, which again looks into the concentration of the platelets, whether the activation is required, and whether the WBCs is required or not. So now, we know all PRPs are not the same. The question is, should we use leukocyte rich or leukocyte poor? And the second is activator versus no activator. Why is there a concern with the leukocytes? It's because leukocytes contains MMP23 matrix metalloproteinases, which can be deleterious. It has got pro-inflammatory mediator production, which can be cell death, and there can be undesirable side effects. On the other hand, there are some in vitro studies which say that a little bit of leukocytes in PRP is good for chondrocyte proliferation and Halron secretion. In our first study, as I said, we had concerns and we used a leukocyte filter. At the same time, Sanchez and team were pioneers in PRP work from Spain. They used a leukocyte poor PRP. Elisabetta Kahn and the team from Italy were using leukocyte rich PRP at the same time. We had a communication with them through this paper regarding the concerns of that. And they came up with a paper a year later, wherein they actually compared leukocyte rich versus leukocyte poor. And they were of the opinion that both leukocyte rich and poor are clinically effective, but leukocyte group has got a little bit of more adverse pain and local swelling. The same findings were seen by Jonathan Ribot study in American Journal of Sports Medicine. This is a recent study of January 2020. I picked this because, again, they compared leukocyte rich, leukocyte poor, and Halron, and they have some contradictory data. They are saying leukocyte rich PRP is better. Otherwise, majority of the studies are saying leukocyte poor is better. But even this study tells that the adverse events are there in leukocyte rich group. So what is the verdict? Both leukocyte rich and both leukocyte poor are equally effective, but there are less side effects with leukocyte poor. We still need to standardize the concentration of leukocyte needed in an ideal PRP preparation for me. The next question is, activator, should we use or no? What do you mean by activator? The activator can be a calcium chloride or a thrombin, which we give along with the PRP. And this is called an exogenous activator. The second option is when they directly come in contact with the tissue, wherein we refer it to as an endogenous activation. We have been using calcium chloride. Now we are shifted to calcium gluconate because it's easily available. But is there a need for activator? There are studies who have used activator, and the proponents say that when we use an activator like calcium, it helps in forming a platelet clot inside and it traps the platelets, and that will give slow release of growth factors. The proponents who say there is no need of activator say anyways the platelets comes in contact with the tissue. That's endogenous activation. So why an extra activator? So there are groups who have been using the activator in their study and doing good randomized controlled trial, and there are people who have been not using activator, but there is no end-on-end study so far. However, we just concluded a randomized controlled trial. This trial is much well planned than our previous trial, had a much bigger number of patients, and we have submitted this in the KSSTA journal, wherein we saw whether activator and non-activator, whether there's a difference, and there was no difference. So it's not necessary to use an activator. The next question is, how many injections? What is the right dosage? The initial studies, if you go at PRP, all use 3 injections. That was because at that time, the other most commonly used thing was a Halron, which was used in 3 injections. So they needed to compare it with the controls. If you look at literature, there are 2 injections, 3 injections, 4 injections, 1 week interval, 2 week interval, 3 week interval, 4 week interval. We were again the first person to compare a single injection with 2 injections in our 2013 published study, And we said that single dose of PRP is as effective as two injections. However, we came up with a study by the Cavada et al. From the Turkey, who said that at least two injections of PRP is appropriate. Then came another study, a well-controlled, it's a good study of the Gormeli et al., again from the Turkey. They said multiple PRP injections are better than single. Then we went back and analyzed what was wrong. Then when we saw the statistics, our single group, single injection and double injection, both were equally good. Both are clinically effective. So if we want to find a minor difference between these two, actually we will need a much bigger sample size because both were effective. So we went back to the preclinical studies. We went back to the guinea pig model. We studied single PRP versus three PRP injections. And we saw that the anti-inflammatory effect of three doses is much better than single PRP at 6 months. At short term of 3 months, there was no difference. But on a longer term, there was good role with three injections. And also we noted chondroprotective effect with three doses of PRP. This was published last year in the American Journal of Sports Medicine again. Now, the second option is how about serial injection? In our original paper, we have mentioned that even though PRP is effective at the end of 6 months, the effects tend to mildly deteriorate, even though it is effective. So why not give at a yearly interval so that we can prolong the effects? And Alberto Gobi and the team exactly came up with a study where they used repeat injection after 1 year. And they said that by giving a repeat injection after 1 year, they could see improved results even at the end of 2 years. So the next question, we know multiple PRP injections seem good. Now, how much to use? So there are two groups. Majority of the studies have been using 4 ml, but we have always been using 8 ml, the same as with Sanchez and their group. We feel the knee is a big joint compared to others, and we can easily accommodate 8 ml. And a simple logic, more the PRP, more the platelets, and more should be the results. And we refer to this as a superdose PRP. Well, so multiple injections seems better, and yearly repeat injections are a safe and good option. Now, which are the ideal indications? It is the same group of patients, that is early osteoarthritis knee, early degenerative chondropathy, or young arthritic knee, wherein you would consider a chondroprotective, like a viscose supplement. Younger patients, lower BMI and less degrees of cartilage degeneration seems to do good. Now, we know that symptomatic relief is there. WOMAC score, KU score, KSS score, all are doing well. But is there an objective change in cartilage? What about MRI after PRP? So there are some interesting studies, even though they all are very small sample size study. This is a study which compared NSAIDs with Hyaluron with single PRP. They said the results, as in terms of the scoring system, WOMAC and VAS, PRP is very good compared to Hyaluron and NSAIDs, but no difference in cartilage thickness or the Kellgren-Lawrence grade. Another study, it was a prospective cohort of 22 patients. Again, good clinical scores, but there was no difference in MRI at the end of 1 year. There's one study which says that patellofemoral cartilage volume and synovitis was better. But as of today, we can say that there is no much role in cartilage regeneration. So how really is PRP working for knee, whether it's cartilage regeneration or anti-inflammatory? So this is the graph of our first study. If you see here, there is mild deterioration at 6 months. If cartilage regeneration was the cause, then there would have been continuing relief. That means anti-inflammatory pain relief is there. We don't know what exactly whether it's cartilage regeneration or not. So anti-inflammatory effect can best explain the clinical results. And overall down modulation of the joint happens. A lot of pathways are involved. The crux of the story is this is the most important mechanism. But this is a recent graph of our recent randomized control trial. You can see that it's continued effect. There have been so many variables in PRP. That exactly is the problem. We over the years have changed the technique of PRP preparation. The PRP which we are using at present is more concentrated than the PRP we were using. It is also the PRP we're using now has a little bit of leukocytes in it. So there are a lot of factors, but we have been seeing persistent effects at 6 months at now, this continuing improvement. Well, the overall PRP works for OA knee. It's a big okay from my side. anti-inflammatory effects, definitely that is a major mechanism. Cartilage regeneration, I don't think. But I think PRP comes somewhere in between where there's something, chondral remodeling stuff happening. What is important for you as clinician is you should what you promise to your patients. Is it pain relief or cartilage regeneration? Please don't give false hope. A word of caution to all. Understand the products and give realistic hope to patients. Tell them, you give PRP, you will get pain relief. Don't tell them, I am going to regenerate your knee. You are not going to need a knee replacement. That is a wrong message. It is used for the symptomatic management. Don't give false expectations. Do not defame PRP. So the take-home message is PRP does have a role in osteoarthritis of the knee. Hitesh, this is the first part of my talk. Do you want me to stop here and take questions or should I go ahead with the next one?
You can continue.
Yeah, fine. So the part two of my talk is, let's talk about PRP use for musculoskeletal injuries. We all know PRP initially made headlines with the musculoskeletal injuries. The famous sportsmen started using the athletes and the PRP therapy, the Tiger Woods, Rafael. Tiger Woods even discussed it in a press conference that PRP has started his, given him a second career. Then Gary Richards is a believer. It has saved careers of so much. This was the hype that PRP really shot in fame. There are a lot of athletes currently in the US who take them. The orthopedic interest was first awakened by Alan Mishra in his tennis elbow study way back in 2006. It was a hot topic of discussion worldwide. A lot of AAOs had their own dedicated session for them. But is there enough evidence? Where is the beef? In 2009, in fact, the most influential article was in a newspaper. It was not in a journal. However, things have changed. After 10 years, there are some evidence. So let's explore one by one area. So let's start with the rotator cuff. So PRP in complete tears wherein the rotator cuff has got a complete tear. The role of PRP used for rotator cuff tear, complete tear, is to augment the repair. Take the message clearly. It is not giving injection and giving them symptom free. If it's a complete tear symptom, we are going to do a shoulder rotator cuff tear. And then as an augmentation, it can be used as a, after doing a cuff tear as an injection or as a platelet fibrin gel during the surgery, we can implant it over there. So the rationale for use is that it assists in tendon to bone interface healing and it can decrease the pain and inflammation in the immediate post-surgery and help in better rehabilitation. So what is the evidence? We got a wonderful meta-analysis from Hurley and the team published in the American Journal of Sports Medicine and another good in operative techniques in sports medicine. The meta-analysis had 18 studies. They looked at the healing rates, clinical scores and pain scores. And they said PRP is better in tears. And platelet-rich fibrin, there was no effect. So there is a Indian Biological Orthopedic Society. We had a consensus group in 2018 and we did a consensus statement. So PRP injection is better and it's a leukocyte poor PRP, which is better. Outcome measures, it definitely reduces pain at 30 days and even at final outcome. But the most important thing was lower re-tear rates with PRP. That means if we use PRP as an augmentation, the re-tear rate was better. That is, it is aiding in the healing. The outcome scores were better and definitely it is safe. We were so happy that in 2019, we had a wonderful meta-analysis from another group and their results were similar to our consensus statements which we delivered. They said PRP treatment with arthroscopic repair of rotator cuff tears decreases the re-tear rate and improves the clinical outcomes. So from the complete tear, let's go to tendinopathy. That is the rotator cuff tendinopathy. So here, PRP is being used under ultrasound guidance as a pain measure injection. So we got some level one studies and not much studies, but we do have some good quality studies. And the message is that it is not good. PRP doesn't have an added benefit over routine physiotherapy and good protocol. So the consensus statement we issued for partial tears or for tendinopathies was that there is no effect of PRP. So let's go from the shoulder to the elbow. There's a lateral epicondylitis of the tennis elbow where all the fame of PRP started with. So we had our share of study from PGI where we used a leukocyte poor PRP for lateral epicondylitis and ultrasound guided, again a randomized controlled trial and the scoring system. And we used in recalcitrant, it's very important. Normal tennis elbow, do in our routine treatment guidelines, we have to follow everything. If it doesn't respond, that is called recalcitrant. We even had patients who had failed steroid injections. So the recalcitrant lateral epicondylitis, we compared with the local anesthetic injection, bupivacaine, and there was improved score at 6 and 12 months, statistically significant for PRP. The pioneer of PRP has been Alan Mishra, who has got more than 7 trials exclusively on tennis elbow. And this is the best study he's got. It's a multicentric study, 230 patients across 12 centers over 5 years. And they said at 24 weeks, clinically meaningful improvements were found in patients treated with leukocyte-enriched PRP. So they have been a proponent of a leukocyte-rich PRP. And then there is this good meta-analysis, which again says that PRP appears to be more effective in relieving pain and improving function at short and long term. By long term, they mean a year. But it's mostly important. This is important. It has to be given under ultrasound guidance. Otherwise, there can be flaw in that. So the consensus statement we issued were leukocyte-rich PRP is useful here. So now the question, why leukocyte-rich here? See, the problem is when PRP you started, if you go to the basics of PRP preparation, we can get either leukocyte-rich PRP or leukocyte-poor PRP. So the Alan Mishra and their group have always used leukocyte-rich PRP. And Sanchez and their team, we all started with leukocyte-poor PRP. Okay, so anyone who wanted to do a trial on PRP and tennis elbow went back to the studies of Alan Mishra and their group and all got leukocyte-rich PRP. So if we look at the literature, some of the best articles are skewed towards leukocyte-rich, and it could be a compounding factor, but nevertheless, literature as on today supports leukocyte-rich PRP for tennis elbow. Volume 2 to 3 ml. Single versus multiple, there's no adequate data, but it's an emerging trend. We can use up to 2 injections, which I'll be presenting shortly. It's always ultrasound guided, and it is definitely superior over steroid and saline. So these are some other articles where how does platelet-rich plasma compare versus open surgical release? So 50 elbows were surgically operated and 60 for PRP. The PRP seems to be better for pain relief and functionality in short and midterm periods. This was a 2016 data. Another arthroscopy ANA data, 101 patients, arthroscopic release in 50, ultrasound guided PRP in 51. This is a very good study because it had 2 years follow up. And see this, PRP injection and arthroscopic release, both were effective in short and medium term, that is up to year, year and a half. But at 2 years, PRP patients experienced a significant worsening of pain. And so at long term, arthroscopic release seems to do better. They concluded that both procedures were safe and well accepted by patients. So that means if you have a very high-end athlete who is getting repeated, do consider arthroscopic debridement because long-term results are good. But otherwise, PRP is equally good for tennis elbow. Another good study for medial epicondylitis in a type 1, again, they said PRP is giving equal and it's an alternative to surgery in medial epicondylitis. So let's go to the ankle area, Achilles tendinopathy. Here, the things are different. These are very good randomized controlled trials. And we have a good meta-analysis, which has got 4 RCTs of 170 patients. PRP is similar to sham bar placebo. That is, PRP has got no added advantage. So this is the latest meta-analysis in 2019. Again, the same thing. PRP is not superior to placebo treatment in Achilles tendinopathy. Let's go to plantar fasciitis. So these are some articles one from Dr. Vijay Shetty and this one from Chandigarh. And we have seen that PRP tends to have good results in plantar fasciitis. The meta-analysis also same. The evidence is limited, but then I have seen over last 1 year, there have been a lot of articles coming up in plantar fasciitis, and I myself have reviewed a lot of articles and all seems to be working. That's even our thing. So there is limited evidence. There's not much evidence compared to osteoarthritis studies or tennis elbow studies, but that limited evidence supports the conclusion that PRP is superior to steroid treatment for long-term pain relief. So PRP is also used in other sports injuries, hamstring injuries, rectus tears, patella tendinopathies. They're promising speedy recovery and return back to sports, but limited evidence, and we need more studies before we can come up with any recommendations. This is a study for patella tendinopathy, which have studied exercise therapy versus PRP, and they said PRP is not no more effective than saline. That is, there is no effect of PRP for patella tendinopathy. So for patella tendinopathy is one good trial which says that there's no role of PRP. Well, as I always say, creativity, we need to be brave, new ideas needs to be taken. So at the last part of my talk, I'll be just giving you insights into some crazy stuff going across, some trends and insights. So this is the Sanchez and the team. They do an all PRP surgery. This is an ACL reconstruction where even for the ACL graft, they're putting in PRP. Even for the plug, the bony plugs are dipped in PRP. And even for the closure, they are doing a PRP. So PRP is used much frequently by them. Another thing is for ACL repair. So what they do is they get an end-to-end repair of the ACL. Then they put in a bracing stuff with an endobutton. So, and then they put in a PRP for glue surrounding the repair so that they can enhance the repair properties. So they are looking at PRP repairs. And next, as similar to the rotator cuff, in meniscal repair. So this is a very good study. 37 patients with complete vertical meniscal tears. They did a repair. They did a repair, and at the intra-repair site, they used PRP or sterile saline. And they noted that the healing of meniscus was significantly higher in the PRP-treated group than in the control group. And the augmentation in meniscus repair results in improvements in both healing and functional outcome. So that's something promising. You know, we can utilize the healing potential of PRP to augment the meniscal repairs we do. And coming to the osteoarthritis, this is a new trend for advanced osteoarthritis, and also the subchondral edema and the subchondral bone as the pathogenesis of osteoarthritis is being recognized now, the importance of subchondral bone, the bone turnover and its role. So now intraosseous infiltrations have been come up by the Sanchez and their group, where they're given to the subchondral edema at the femur and the medial side of the tibia, and if there's patellofemoral over there. So they have come up with a local biologic joint-centric approach to treat knee OA. What they mean is that they give intra-articular injection that will take care of the synovium and the superficial cartilage layer. And then they give an intraosseous for the deeper zones of the articular cartilage and the subchondral bone. So that can have effect on all the sites. It can target, and hence they have been using it in advanced osteoarthritis as well with good results. So what we know so far, there is strong evidence in few conditions like osteoarthritis, epicondylitis, plantar fasciitis, rotator cuff repair augmentation. Weak evidence in rotator cuff tears and tendinopathy, Achilles tendinosis, patella tendinosis, and hamstring tears. Well, as I started off, we are all in search of the Holy Grail. We're all in search of the Amrit. We may need a cup of nectar or Indian whiskey. It could be the stem cells, the growth factors, platelet-rich plasma, gene therapies, all are there in the horizon. At least PRP has come much way ahead, being used everywhere. This is an ad, you know, vampire facelift. PRP is used for cosmetic purposes as well. It's even used for baldness. I couldn't stop sharing this slide. Well, I tend to agree with the vampires. Blood is good. It heals many things. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah, I'm done.
That was a brilliant presentation, and you have covered almost everything about PRP. And it was nice to listen to you.
Thank you.
One of the questions was, can you mention, can you just say again, strong evidence of PRP for which all conditions? Would you mind repeating that?
Yeah. For osteoarthritis knee, there is very strong evidence. But I'll tell you the problem why there is disgrace in the society. I would again come to tell you. We want to understand the role. When we're talking about PRP, again, there are people who are spoiling it. We should understand why we are using it. For symptomatic pain relief, for early osteoarthritis, early stages of degeneration, 45 years, 55 years, we know x-rays, they are not advanced stage. So there, it tends to work. They give very good results. The problem is if you are expecting cartilage regeneration, see, when you look back at animal studies or a petri dish study, that is different. Petri dish studies, there is chondrocytes. We are giving PRP dose into it. So PRP tends to show us chondrocyte growing and all. But you have to understand PRP has got restricted time period of action inside the knee. So what we see in a petri dish does not truly come to real life situation. So over the time, the effects tends to wear off. The predominant mechanism which can explain clinical results is anti-inflammatory. There may be chondral remodeling, all those things, but we cannot expect it to last. So it is definitely, there is not much confusion when people are talking about Hyaluron, right? So they are the same indications, but it has got a edge over Hyaluron in terms of its safety, as well as the clinical studies say that it tends to do better than Hyaluron. So that is for osteoarthritis. The second part is a sports injury and the tendinopathy. There's a lot of evidence for the tennis elbow and the medial epicondyle, that the elbow. Elbow PRP works. We can use up to 2 injections. Rotator cuff, not as an injection for pain, for tendinosis, but a rotator cuff surgeon who is doing repairs for greatly retracted. We know when we try to pull it, we cannot bring it back much better way. But still, so if you want an added healing effect over there, if we can augment it. So there, the evidence is in favor of augmentation of rotator cuff tears. Next, moving to the lower limbs, patellar tendinopathy, no role. Limited studies, but there are good randomized control trials in the AJSM, which says there's no role in patellar tendinosis. Achilles tendinosis and tendinopathy, there are at least 5 good randomized control trials in the meta-analysis, which says, again, it is similar to SHAM, there is no role. Plantar fasciitis, there is role. Evidence is coming up and even our results, we have seen good results in plantar fasciitis. And this is it. The other all conditions, experimentally, they are using it. We need another 3-4 years to comment upon its use for other conditions.
Okay, Sandeep, on a personal note, not exactly Achilles tendinitis. You see a lot of patients with Haglund deformity and a swelling, retroperitoneal bursitis. On a personal note, I have had very good experience using PRP for that. Otherwise, I don't use PRP for anything else. I just use PRP. I have so many patients who were advised surgery. They have come to me and I've just given one shot of PRP and they're very happy with that.
No, see, that's exactly what. We may get good results. I'm talking about the evidence. I have used for rectus tears. I use for hamstring tears in our sports medicine clinic. I've got results, but the volume is less to comment upon them.
Yeah, but true. Yes, it is level 5. No. My opinion is just level 5, but I'm just telling, see, ultimately, yes, what happens is you need to combine evidence with the experience.
True.
The only evidence, I know that's the way forward, but you need to combine a little bit with experience and only then you can give the best to your
students. We're also starting the intraosseous injections for some advanced lesions, because you must, again, this is something new. If you see, the subchondroplasty term is coming up these days. That means overall there is a understanding of the subchondral bone as an important thing in osteoarthritis. I'm re-emphasizing this because now, see, the Zimmer is coming up with a subchondroplasty, and initially you go back around the 5-7 years or 10 years, they were using alendronate in the subchondral bone injection, because that subchondral bone has got, if the subchondral bone breaks, then the support is breaking. The osteoarthritis tends to progress biologically. So the Sanchez and the team and so many people are using intraosseous injections. And I think this is something interesting, which we can try on patients, and that can give much better results in osteoarthritis.
Okay, Sandeep. Another one question is, I know PRP sometimes when you buy from commercial point of view, it's a bit expensive. So I have some of my colleagues and myself, we have used, what we do is we send the blood to for centrifugation and we just take the supernatant. We found that's a very simple and cost effective method. It's very cheap.
Yes.
What is it?
I'll tell you. I didn't include in my talk, but then I have a separate talk where I talk about how we prepare PRP, how to get PRP concentration, what are the types and all. But I can tell you in a simplified way. When we take blood, it is simple. Even if we leave it in the room, in a desk, the blood set tends to settle because of the gravitational force G. So the blood will be at the bottom. Then we have the WBC. Then we have the platelets and the plasma. So if we put in the centrifugation machine and spin it, what happens is that G, gravitational force, increases and the settling will occur early. So here is the fine balance, how much we need to spin. So here there is some technical things, how much is the spin speed and all. So first will be always the blood at the bottom. Then we have the WBC. Now, depending on a two spin technique or a single spin technique, that is a buffy coat. So if we use a buffy coat technique, the whole platelets will be in the buffy coat. So, but that buffy coat will also have leukocytes. So if we take out, we get very concentrated PRP with leukocytes. The second thing is we centrifuge it less. So we take off the leukocytes, but that is at the expense of PRP. We lose PRP, the platelets also. So we have come up with a platelet pellet technique, something different. So where we are getting highly concentrated PRP. So it's a very simple technique, but only one advice to everyone is you should know what you are using. It also holds true for the commercial products. I have come across with some commercial products, which when I try to analyze them, the concentration is not there. So all your PRP patients, you are taking blood, right? Last 1 ml, send it for platelet count. And after giving injection, last 0.5 ml, send it for platelet counts, right? So we know the blood platelets and what we got it. It should be more than 3 to 4 times concentrated to call it as PRP. This is the best way. We should know what we are injecting. So any technique would matter. There are a lot of cost-effective techniques. As you said, even we are getting it done in the transfusion department itself. But have a data of what you're injecting. Even the commercial kids guys can fool you around. We never know. And I'll tell you one more recent advances in PRP. There is an exercise regime. I mean, if you make patients walk on that treadmill for 10 minutes and then take the PRP, the platelet concentration is more because the platelets, they also tend to be homing in the bone marrow or whatever. So when they start exercising the peripheral blood, the platelets come in and then you draw the blood, we get a better yield. So this is a US study. I mean, they have done 4-5 studies. One recently, it was there 2 days back. So just I was going through that. So that is something we can try. You know, keep ask them to do a brisk walking for 20 minutes and come and then draw the blood.
Okay, so that's a new walking PRP.
Yeah.
Or post-exercise PRP.
Yeah, post-exercise PRP, yeah.
Thank you very much for sharing your time with us. It was very enlightening talk, and I think we have conveyed a strong message on the use of PRP in the ideal indications for PRP and where you need to be cautious about PRP as well. So thank you once again, Sandeep, for sharing your time with us. Look forward for more from you.
Thank you. It was wonderful associating with you and giving this talk. Thank you.
Thank you very much.